wounds which by their chosen one bring many sons to glory. Behold the man upon the cross, my sin upon his shoulders. Ashamed, I hear my mocking voice call out among the scoffers. It was my sin that held him there until it was accomplished. His dying breath has brought me life. I know that it is finished. I will not boast in anything, no gifts, no power, no wisdom, but I will boast in Jesus Christ.
Well, hey, good morning, Grace. Welcome. You might be wondering why I have a piece of bread in my hand here. This morning, we're focusing on the part of the Lord's Prayer where Jesus invites us to pray, "Give us this day our daily bread." So we're going to find out what that can mean for us today. Thanks for being here with us.
This morning we will be reading the Lord's Prayer in Spanish. If you are able to do so, please follow along. If not, the words will be on the screen in English. Padre nuestro que estás en los cielos, santificado sea tu nombre. Venga tu reino, hágase tu voluntad, como en el cielo, así también en la tierra. El pan nuestro de cada día, dánoslo hoy. Y perdónanos nuestras deudas, como también nosotros perdonamos a nuestros deudores. Y no nos metas en tentación, mas líbranos del mal. Porque tuyo es el reino, y el poder, y la gloria por todos los siglos. Amén.
Above all kings. amazing grace. This is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross, you would lay down your life, that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain.
Will you pray with me? God, I thank you so much for our church body. I thank you so much for the ways that we have been faithful. But I'm most grateful for the ways that you have been faithful to us in this season. And God, how we have seen your work through so many, and we have seen you move even in this crazy time. God, I ask this morning as we prepare our hearts to hear worship and hear the sermon that we are focused on you, and that we are expecting to hear from you. God, we love you so much. In Jesus' name, amen.
Well, good morning, church. Things are a little bit different today. You're going to see Justin a little bit later, given the word. And I have the amazing privilege to lead with such a phenomenal band, you in worship. And today we're going to be talking about the Lord's Prayer, the third line, and it says, give us this day our daily bread. And I think that is a phenomenal reminder for us as believers to not be afraid to ask the Lord for constant nourishment, both spiritually and physically. I would love if you joined as we sang this song together. He's our rescuer. He's our rescuer. We are free from sin forevermore. Oh, how sweet the sound. Oh, how grace abounds. We will praise the Lord, our rescuer. There is good news for the captive. Good news for the shame. There is good news for the one who walked away. For the doubting, one religion's failed, for the good Lord has come to seek and save. He's our rescuer, he's our rescuer, we are free from
wrongs we have done. Omniscient, all-knowing, he counts not their sum. Thrown into a sea without bottom or shore. Our sins, they are many, his mercy is more. Would wait as we constantly wait. The Father, so tender, is calling us home. He welcomes the weakest, the vilest, the poor. Our sins, they are many, his mercy is more. Praise the Lord. Was the payment, his life was the cause. We stood near the debt we could never afford. Our sins, they are many, his mercy is more. Praise the Lord, his mercy is
morning and welcome to Grace. We are so glad that you are here this morning. If this is your first time with us, thank you for joining us. There's a welcome card in the comments below that you can fill out. We would love to connect with you. I have a few announcements for you this morning. November is right around the corner. Can you believe it? It is almost here. And to kick off November, Karis has put together a virtual prayer walk. And the great thing about this, you can do it from home and you get to travel all around the world. Their first stop is in Argentina. And in Argentina, they will be praying for all the missionaries that are there. There will be 30 stops. It will go through the whole month of November, so you don't want to miss out. You can also find the link to that in the description below. And November 7th, men's breakfast. Guys, it's your time to shine. You know, the first Saturday of every month is just for you. And on the 7th, you will be joined by Pastor Tim. Pastor Tim will be leading a discussion all about wisdom. And we definitely need wisdom these days. Wouldn't you agree? He's going to be talking about how to live well in our world today. So those are a few things you want to mark on the calendar. All the links are in the video description, or you can visit graceSealBeach.org to get all the information. Would you take a moment and pray with me this morning? Heavenly Father, we are so grateful for your presence in our lives. Thank you because you never leave our side. God, I praise you because you are in control of the entire world. You hold it all within your grasp. And just like you watch for our missionaries who serve across the ocean, you also care for us here where we're at and our simple needs and our big needs. Lord, you are aware of them all. Lord, I pray that you would continue to guide us. Help us to make wise decisions in the upcoming days and weeks. Lord, help us to just trust you and know that you are fully in control of all things. Thank you for loving us the way you do. Thank you for your Son, Jesus Christ. And in his name we pray, amen.
Why don't you sing this chorus with us just one more time? And would you pray with me this prayer of illumination? Gracious God, we do not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from your mouth. Make us hungry for this word, that it may nourish us today in the way of eternal life. Through Christ Jesus, the bread of heaven. Amen.
Today's reading is from Matthew 7, 8 through 11, and Matthew 6, 11. For everyone who asks receives, and the one who seeks finds, and to the one who knocks it will be opened. Or which one of you, if your son asks him for bread, will give him a stone? Or if he asks for a fish, will give him a serpent? If you then, who are evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your Father who is in heaven give good things to those who ask him? Give us this day our daily bread. This is the word of the Lord.
So give us this day our daily bread. That's the part of our prayer that we're looking at this morning. And on face value, we might wonder, how do we pray a prayer like this? A daily kind of needs-based prayer when many of us have what we need close by us in our modern, industrial, affluent age that we live in, where our grocery stores are full and there's pallets of food at Costco. You might wonder, how do we pray a prayer like this? Should we pray a prayer like this? Could we? What would be in it for us? What could we get out of it if we did pray this kind of prayer? And I know many of us are used to having somewhat what we need. And yet, a couple of months ago, we did experience a bit of scarcity. And I don't know if you wandered around the grocery stores a few months ago looking for toilet paper or baby wipes, but you might have noticed, like I did, these empty shelves. I mean, just cobwebs blowing through them, where it used to be stacked with every kind of toilet paper you could ever imagine, and now it's just empty. And you're staring at these empty shelves. What was that like for you? Were you wondering, like, how am I gonna get this item, you know? And this was something that we kind of need, toilet paper. And here it was, questionable of whether we could get it. In the disciples' day, when they were hearing this prayer, this was a bit of what their life was like, without refrigeration and with daily wages and a life that's dependent on the weather and crops and soil for food. Jesus' invitation to ask God for our daily bread was practical for them. It was challenging for them. And it was just that. It was an invitation to trust God. For today, having an abundance of wealth for us is not a kind of a pass. It's not a reason to dismiss this prayer as maybe it's not important for us, those that have kind of what we need when we want it. It's actually more the reason that we should make this prayer our own, that we should lean into it and see what it has for us. One author writes, "I am in greater spiritual danger when I have plenty than when I have nothing." And he says, there's almost a greater need of the wealthy to cry out to God for mercy that they may not fail to trust him. You know, the Bible says there's challenges and temptations on either side of poverty or wealth. But the challenge, the temptation of wealth, is the failure to trust God. And this trusting him, this is the basis of relationship. You may have heard relationships are based on trust, right? And that's true in this case as well. You've heard Christianity is not a religion, it's a relationship. Well, one of the pillars of this relationship is trust. And this opportunity for us to connect with God by depending on him. This prayer is an invitation to intimacy. For us, it's an invitation to connection to God, to realize our smallness in the reality of his bigness, to depend on him and to receive from him in his perfect, loving way. Give us this day our daily bread. And so the invitation is to ask. But isn't asking challenging for so many of us? What is it about guys and directions, right? We don't want to ask for help with directions. We're like, we can figure this out. We're going to just grip this thing in our own two hands with this crumpled up map, and we're going to find our way through this. And if you've been driving around in circles with a carload of impatient passengers, how's that worked out for you? Right? It's not that great. It doesn't work out that great. And yet there's something challenging about asking. It's kind of a humbling exercise. It's an act of vulnerability to say that we need some help or that we need something. But don't you hate it when you hear someone say, oh, you just should have asked, you know, or like, I wish I would have known, you know? And you feel like you missed out on some exchange, some favor or something. And sometimes it's some pretty big stuff like, oh, I wish you would have asked. I have season tickets. I mean, you could just watch the game in my executive box or whatever. I'm never there. Or like, oh, a cabin in the woods or something like that. You know, you feel like, oh, if I would have just asked, I could have got in on this incredible experience. And this happened for me in a really personal, unique way. Many years ago, when many of you know, I toured around full time with my music, and that meant traveling each weekend to sing as a special musical guest kind of at different churches. And this one time I flew into this town and I got to my host home where they were hosting me, and I opened up my suitcase in my room and I noticed that my ukulele was cracked. Something happened in the luggage and at the top was kind of smashed in, and there was some cracks along the top, and it was enough that the strings wouldn't hold tension and it wouldn't play. And I was just kind of bummed because I had these big ideas for using my ukulele that next morning in the church service as part of this musical presentation I was doing. And I was just, you know, kind of talking to God and scrambling, thinking of a plan B. And then I felt like I heard this voice. Maybe it was God, and there's just this voice that said, you should ask your host home family about this broken ukulele. Ask them if they have any ideas for you or something, or how to fix it, or I don't know. And I just thought, no, I'm not going to do that, because there's no way that this nice little suburban house in this neighborhood has a wood shop or special furniture clamping tools or glues or things that would fix this ukulele right now. I mean, it's in the evening time. That's the next morning. That's so far-fetched, I'm not even going to go there. So I didn't. And the next morning, the man, the host home guy, the father of the house, he was going to drive me to the church service, and we went outside, and he opened up his garage because he had forgot something. And in the garage, I see like these long wooden slats, these like poles, they're all lined up all along the garage, along the sides, hanging in the middle, different skinny shapes. And I hadn't seen anything like that in my life. I thought they were maybe golf club holders or frames, under these tall skinny things, different sizes. So I just asked him, what is all this stuff? What is your garage full of? And he goes on to explain that his hobby is furniture making and furniture repair, and these are wooden frames, different size frames that hold wood together, where he uses his special glue to build furniture and to restore old furniture. And this is his passion, this is his craft, this is his greatest skill. And I just felt like, oh, I missed out on getting this ukulele fixed, but I missed out on a relationship with this guy, like a chance to connect on a deeper level with this person who had these skills and this passion, and I could have received and been a part of this really cool exchange. And the same is true with us and God. We have an opportunity to ask God for help, and He is wanting to meet our needs. This word bread in the Bible, it's used in many different ways to mean all kinds of food. And it can mean even things that we need for life, clothing or health or, you know, structures, the strength to work, shelter, all these kind of things is meant by this word. Everything we need to live. And God is inviting us to ask Him for everything that we need. Not our greeds, but our needs. And Jesus' use of the word bread, in this passage. It also has a connection to the first time in history when God actually provided bread to the people in need. In Exodus 16, God's people were in the desert wandering around and they were hungry and they cried out to God, and God actually provided bread, miraculous bread, right down from heaven, like pouring down from the sky onto the ground for them to gather up and to eat. This bread, this was called manna, and this special kind of bread-like substance, it was not meant to be preserved. It couldn't last a night or a day or two. It was only meant to be gathered right then, that day, and eaten through the day, and then it's gone. And the next morning, the people would have to come out again and trust God and wait for his provision. So why did God design the manna like that? He could have made any kind of bread. But there's this verse in Deuteronomy 8 that gives us a clue of why he did it. It's this: that he might make you know that man does not live by bread alone, but man lives by every word that comes from the mouth of the Lord. So this specifically designed bread, it was intended to help the people of God rely on him, to develop a conscious dependence on God for their needs each day. You know, just like that furniture maker I was staying with, there's this opportunity to receive from God in his perfect way, in his perfect timing. And I know that many of us might think, well, I don't want to ask God for small stuff. I might be bugging God. You know, and maybe you've grown up in a family where you didn't feel like you could ask a lot of questions. Maybe your parents or your father was not really welcoming to a lot of questions. Maybe if you're honest and you're a father of young children right now, you've been asked a lot of questions and you're kind of like, I'm done. I don't want to help. I don't want to answer things. I don't want to tie your shoes again. You know, maybe you can relate to that, and you might think God feels that same way. But this verse reminds us that that is not true, that God loves it when we go to him with our needs. In fact, this verse asks us, it prompts us, it challenges us to go to God first with our needs. I mean, we can so many times be tempted to look at other solutions around us and go to God as a last resort. You know, we can like, well, I need to look at my bank account first and check it out. I need to just check in with my friends on social media, maybe see what they say. Or, you know, I need to kind of consult my this or look at Google or whatever. And God's saying, hey, those aren't bad necessarily, but would you go to me first? Come to me first with your needs. Go to him first. And note that this prayer, it's plural. And we've been talking about this throughout this series, that the Lord's Prayer isn't me and mine, it's us and ours. And this is no exception. Give us this day our daily bread. It's a plural prayer, and the plurality of it, it nudges us, right? It kind of pivots us to consider the needs of others and the people around us. So we not only pray for our own bread, but we pray for those who have none. And God often meets our needs in surprising ways, sometimes miraculous, like seemingly right down from the sky, but other times through one another, through the generosity of one another and being open to the gifts that God gives us through community. And our church, the way we've stepped out in that, one of the ways is through a thing called the Caring Fund. And we have people that through generosity have been giving money to this Caring Fund that is in place for people that need help. And there's thousands of dollars in there now. And it's an open thing for people to apply for, to ask about, and to present their need and to ask this Caring Fund committee, you know, kind of a thing where there's availability here to help. Maybe that's something that God wants to invite you to. Maybe he's asking you, inviting you to check something out like this, to say, how might God meet this need in my life? You know, just think, what if everyone prayed this prayer? What if everyone in the world prayed, give us this day our daily bread? If everyone was looking out for everyone else and bringing everyone's needs to God, I mean, could you imagine our world. We might solve the hunger problem across the globe. Who knows? Now, I know that one of the objections coming up might be, or one of the challenges might be, okay, Justin, I get it that asking God is good, he welcome's it, okay, asking's cool. But here's the other side of the coin. What will I receive? Like, can I trust him to actually give me what I need? I can ask, okay, cool, but will God really provide? Will God really come through for me? There's that trust again, right? Is God trustworthy? Well, the short answer is yes. Because of his nature, because of from the beginning of time, he's been a loving father whose resources are limitless and whose wisdom is matchless. We were reminded of that through that verse that we heard at the very beginning of this service, at the beginning of this sermon in Matthew 7. I'll read it again. It says, "Ask and it will be given to you. Seek and you will find. Knock and it will be opened to you. For everyone who asks receives, and the one who seeks finds, and the one who knocks, it will be open." And this last awesome part says, "And how much more will your Father who is in heaven give good things to those who ask him?" So we're not only invited to ask God, but we're invited to open our hands and to receive the goodness that he has for us. So what do you truly need? What do you truly need today? What if you could bring that to God, to open your hands to receive from him, the creator of the universe, who created all things and who wants to give you his goodness? Well, there's one thing that God wants to give just right off the top. There's one thing that he knows that you and I need even more than we know it. And he knows it's kind of a background piece that goes along with all of this asking and receiving. That's a part of the waiting for us. And here's what it is. Are you ready? God wants to give you peace. He wants to bring you peace. In the middle of the worries and the uncertainties of this season that are crashing around us, Jesus wants to stand up and calm the storm in your life. You know, right after this prayer, a couple sentences later, Jesus encourages the listeners to look at nature, to look at the birds and the flowers, and the way that God has designed nature to work together in such a beautiful, perfect harmony. And he reminds the listeners that the birds and the flowers, that they don't need to worry about what they're going to eat or what they're going to wear, that God takes care of them each day. And that God, just in the same way, will take care of us. And he loves us so deeply. And then he caps it off with this in verse 31. "Therefore, do not be anxious, saying, 'What shall we eat? Or what shall we drink? Or what shall we wear?' For the Gentiles seek after all these things, and your heavenly Father knows that you need them all. But seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added to you. Therefore, do not be anxious about tomorrow, for tomorrow will be anxious for itself." God wants to bring you peace. He wants to remove that anxiety and replace it with his peace as we go to him in prayer, as we bring our requests to him. Philippians 4, 6 and 7, again, it says, "Don't be anxious about anything, but in everything, in prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus." Prayer is the antidote to worry. You know, because the Lord is close to us, we don't need to be anxious, and we can pray because he is close to us. Psalm 34:15 reminds us, "The eyes of the Lord watch over those who do right, and his ears are open to their cries for help. God is here. God is listening. He invites our requests, and he wants to meet us right where we're at with his peace and to meet those needs in his perfect way. You know, this prayer of asking and receiving from God, it's particularly poignant for my wife and I, for Heidi and I, as we look ahead to this summer coming up to move to my hometown and plant a brand new church. I mean, the vision has been stirring for many years, and there's so much excitement and encouragement, but there's also a lot of uncertainties. There's so many things that have yet to be realized. What would they look like? How will this go? And for us, this prayer, what a great reminder it is to bring our requests to God, to go to him first. You know, our org charts and our strategies and our timelines and our budgets and things, those are helpful things and they're good things. But the reminder for us is to not go to those first or rely on those, but to go to God first, not as a last ditch option when everything else sort of falls apart. Then go to God. No, go to God first, just right off the top, to turn to him each day with our needs. And then it's a reminder for us to keep our hands open to what God wants to give us what we need, not what we think we need. So how about for you? What is it in your life that right now, this morning, you could bring to God? What's a situation in your life that you feel that he's reminding you to go to him first with? You know, maybe you're a high school student and you're thinking about college and your future. Maybe you've got, you know, tests and all sorts of things that are stressful, and there's so many temptations to kind of try and do things yourself, figure things out yourself. And here's this invitation to ask God for help. Ask him for help in deciding where to go. Ask him for help with your tests and the academics that you have in front of you, or the challenges with your friends. Ask God for help. Maybe you're that young adult with those young kids I mentioned before, and you've got this house full of people, and you're trying to spin all these plates in the middle of this quarantine season and all the challenges. And this is just a reminder to pull back and to ask God, the Prince of Peace, for help in your life. And to be open to see what he has for you. To be ready to be surprised by what his goodness looks like for you. Maybe you're on the other side. You're in your older years and you've raised children. And you've been leaving a legacy of your life. And here's a chance again to open your hands and ask for help. What is it in front of you that you need God to meet you in? And what would it look like for you to give these years ahead for you to God in a fresh way and say, God, would you lead me, show me, give me what I need as we trust him, right? As we depend on him. The Heidelberg Catechism, an old writing in the early church, it says this: I trust him so much that I do not doubt he will provide whatever I need for body and soul, and he will turn to my good whatever adversity he sends me in this sad world. I trust him so much that I do not doubt. May that be true for us, that we would trust him so much. Psalm 145 gives us such a beautiful poetic picture of who God is in this way. It says, the eyes of all look to you in hope. You give them their food as they need it. When you open your hand, you satisfy the hunger and thirst of every living thing. So bring your hunger and your thirst today to Jesus. Let him surround you with his peace. Let his provision sustain you. You know, there's one last perspective on this word bread that we can, as we pray this prayer today, we can keep this in mind. And it's this, it's where Jesus is talking about himself in John 6. In verse 33, Jesus says, The bread of God is the one who comes down from heaven. Remember that manna coming down from heaven? And he gives life to the world. And then they told him, "Sir, give us this bread all the time." And Jesus told them, "I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never be hungry. Whoever believes in me will never become thirsty." So Jesus is the true bread of life. And when we pray, "Give us this day our daily bread," we're asking for Jesus to give us himself, to fill our lives with all the fullness of him, his power, his strength, his grace, his mercy. And we need this every day. So let's come to him now. Let's ask. Let's receive. Let's ask that we might be those kind of people who look out for the needs of others. As we keep our eyes on the lookout for those that have none, that we might hold them in these prayers as we bring them to God. That we might be a part of helping people turn to God for their needs and to depend on him and to receive everything they need for life. We should pray this prayer today. "Give us this day our daily bread," because it reminds us that all we need comes from God. It prompts us to look out for the needs of others. It brings us peace knowing that God cares about our needs. And finally, it points our soul to Jesus, who is the true bread of life. Let's pray together. Jesus, we do want to come to you in this moment right now. And God, we want to just take a moment of silence to bring our unique situation, our unique need to you. We want to ask you for help and ask you to meet our need. Let's take a moment of silence to do that now. Give us this day our daily bread. Give us this day our daily bread. Give us this day our daily bread. God, we're so thankful that the eyes of all do look to you in hope. And God, we're so grateful that you give us our food as we need it. God, remind us in this moment that when you open your hand, that you satisfy the hunger and thirst of every living thing. Meet our needs today, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen.
As you go ahead and grab your communion items, why don't you come and sing with us a song.
Peace, bring it all to peace. The storm surrounding me, let it break. At your name still, call the sea to still. The rage within me still, let me wave. Jesus, you make the darkness tremble. Jesus, Jesus, the silence fear. Jesus, Jesus, you make the darkness tremble. Jesus, Jesus. Call these bones to breathe, call these lungs to sing once again. I praise Jesus, Jesus, you make the darkness tremble. Jesus, Jesus,
Well, it is so fitting on this morning as we think about this prayer, give us this day our daily bread, to respond here at the communion table. Because Jesus says in Matthew 26, 26, he just says it as plain as day, this is my body. Jesus, the true bread of life. So we invite you, if you want to take communion together with us, to put your faith in Jesus as the true bread of life, would you join with us this morning? In Matthew 26, it says, now as they were eating, Jesus took the bread, and after blessing it, he broke it, and he gave it to his disciples. And he said, take, eat, this is my body broken for you. Let's pray together. God, thank you so much for giving your life for us. Thank you so much for being the bread of life that satisfies the hunger of our soul. Draw us close to you. Increase our faith to trust you. In Jesus' name, amen. The body of Jesus broken for you. Let's eat. And then it says, he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, drink of it, all of you, for this is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for the many for the forgiveness of sins. Let's pray. God, thank you for your blood that was shed for us, that you gave your life in our place, that we might have life. Thank you, Jesus. In your name we pray. Amen. The blood of Jesus spilled for you. Let's drink. Well, Jesus, we thank you for your mercy and grace upon us and for all who will believe. And may we continue to proclaim it, your glorious gospel, until you come. And all of the church says, even now, come quickly, Lord Jesus.
Jesus, Jesus, you make the darkness tremble. Jesus, Jesus, the silence fear. Jesus, Jesus, darkness tremble. Jesus,
let me pray a benediction over you. May you be filled to the brim with the goodness of God, the nourishment of Jesus Christ, the bread of life, and the power of the Holy Spirit. Go now in peace to serve God in all that you think, do, and say, and may God's peace be with you. Amen.